G'day YouTubers, and welcome to this kind of brief, I'm always scared when I say that, but brief look inside the HP 3561A. So this is a dynamic signal analyzer. Now, just to give you a run through what we're going to cover off in this video, I'm going to explain why I've purchased this. I'm going to also go through my buying experience on eBay, just to things to be aware of. I've got it opened up. I will show you inside. We're not going to totally go over all the detail of how it works, because it's obviously quite a complex little machine. But I have taken some photographs of the processes of cleaning it up and resolving some issues, although I have introduced another issue, which I'm going to talk about and hopefully solve. It's still a very functional device. It's going to do what I want to do, but I'll bring you in closer to you so you can have a look at it and what have you. But anyway, so let's get into the discussion of why I went and bought this dynamic signal analyzer. I already have several other signal analyzers on my bench, and I've at one point in time had a real-time signal analyzer. So why this one? I am on a little bit of a mission. Another passion project of mine is to do with audio and music, and in particular recording formats and playback formats, digital formats. I have a lot of analog equipment, reel-to-reel tape, a turntable, a nice old vintage cassette deck, which have all been refurbished and calibrated so they're operating correctly. So I like my music from both the analog side and the digital side. The digital side is far more convenient. And like many folks, I've also been caught up in this thing of high-res music, right? And I'll put this wonderful little logo, Hi-Res, which I think is such a catch for so many people and has pulled money out of so many people's pockets. And even recently, I've seen videos where people are going on about the benefits of the high resolution music. It should be called high sampling, or I don't know, but to me this high resolution name that's given to a music that is sampled at a higher frequency is such a misnomer. And so anyway, I'm on a mission to do some testing and show that perhaps there aren't the huge benefits that people think in terms of these higher sample rates. But to do that, I've got a few practical demonstrations. One of the interesting things which I've been researching is when I started getting into this, playing with DACs, playing, looking at the frequency when things start aliasing and folding back, which is why I have this. I suddenly realized there's another big limiting factor. You know, it's not the one, the first obvious one is our own hearing. Why do people want to be able to have these higher sampler rates with the potential of hearing things above 20 kilohertz? I know my hearing is already down to about 14.6 kilohertz. As soon as you're into your teens, your hearing is potentially going to drop to 18 kilohertz, 16 kilohertz. So people have this thing that they're missing out on something up there, and I'm going to test that. I'm going to do some recordings. My daughter plays a clarinet, and it's one of the instruments with a high frequency range. I want to look at the harmonics that go into the ultrasonic range, just to do that comparison. But to me, the one big limiting factor is not even your ears or trying to capture those harmonics. It's the microphones in studios. So I've got a reference mic. I'm going to go through all of that. But to do that, I started using my Regal signal analyzer. But the challenges with that device is the way it works, because it's a cheaper signal analyzer, it does a sweep of a certain frequency range. And because you're sweeping and not looking at the whole frequency range immediately, it's potentially slow on performance. You're certainly not going to capture intermittent signals or what have you. And if you've got a dynamic, a changing signal, particularly if you want to kind of have a finer resolution bandwidth, certainly the window that you're looking at your signal of interest, then it slows down completely. Also, its starting frequency is 9 kilohertz. It can see things below 9 kilohertz, but then the amplitude measurement isn't accurate at all. Many of the signal analyzers start at 9 kilohertz and up. Some of the modern real-time frequency analyzers or signal analyzers do start at DC and go up, but they cost anywhere from $5,000, $10,000, $20,000, $30,000, $40,000, for those devices. I've had a real-time analyzer, but again, that started 9 kilohertz and up. I've got a vector signal analyzer, which is an old HP, which is, again, that's got good high performance, but it also, that starts at an even higher frequency because it's used for RF work. So once you want to look at frequencies below 9 kilohertz, you then have to start looking at audio test equipment, audio real-time analyzers. And many of those actually are then limit themselves between, let's say, 0 hertz and up to 20 kilohertz. But I do want to look at the area immediately above 20 kilohertz for harmonics from instruments in particular. So this goes up to 100 kilohertz. It goes from just above DC, 125 millihertz, all the way up to 100 kilohertz. And what this is using is FFT. Real-time analyzers will have various filters where they bring in a signal and they can analyze a certain band of frequencies in real time. This doesn't quite do that. It can do a narrow band just about in real time, but it is a lot faster than certainly the SWET frequency analyzer that I've got. These are selling on eBay for reasonable prices, although you have to be very careful trying to find one. I found a lot where, let's say, the screen is damaged. This one, when I got it, the top end of the screen was poking out a bit. So let me tell you about the listing. I paid $600. So even for some of these vintage analyzers, you are going to end up paying thousands of dollars, particularly if you're looking at anything that's real time. The dynamic signal analyzers were primarily used for either audio work or analyzing vibrations. So you can attach, you've got a setting here where you can attach a vibration sensor or probe, pick up vibrations and then analyze that on here as well, because it's within lower than 100 kilohertz. The limitation, I think, with the 100 kilohertz is to do with the analog to digital converter. In 1984, when these were first brought out, there was a limitation with the speed of the analog to digital converter, and I think that limited these to 100 kilohertz. This one in particular, I've noted there are some ICs which are dated 1984, but the sticker on the back notes 1988. So this one was produced in 1988, and for the most part, it's in good shape. But how it's in good shape now, because I've spent a lot of time cleaning it. I've also done some calibration. I'm going to talk about the calibration and the issue I've come across. But when it was sold to me, it said in very good clean working condition. And I took a magnifying glass, and this is what I often do when I look at items on eBay, because sometimes the pictures aren't zoomed in enough and you need to see a bit more detail. I could see that it didn't look like the cleanest unit, but I thought, okay, if it's working, I can perhaps do a bit of a cleanup, no problem. Got it here, and honestly, there was a lot of rubbish and grot between the keys. I'll try and insert, I should have taken a photograph before I actually cleaned it up. I've got photographs of the process as I cleaned it up, but it was really grotty and dirty. There was a lot of soot from the CRT. This has obviously got an old cathode ray tube in it. There's a lot of soot, and I've tried to look this up, but I don't know whether the soot is a side effect of the high voltages in the CRT, but there was soot all over the high voltage supply to the screen. And I noted, in fact, in eBay that a portion of the screen seemed to be a little darker. And I thought, okay, that might have faded over time, but it's not going to upset the work that I want to do. But once I started cleaning, I realized that soot had got between the little fine mesh on the front of the screen here. So literally cleaning all that up has resolved all of that. But one of the key problems in terms of its functionality was that two of these buttons, selection buttons on the side of the screen, were not operating correctly. So that was a key reason I took it apart. I thought I'd just quickly try and resolve that. I wasn't going to do a video. I just wanted to do it quickly, so I had it up and running to do the work I wanted to do. But as I opened it up and I saw all the muck and the dust inside and all the soot, I thought, okay, let me just take a few photographs, and now I've decided to do this video just to give you a little close-up on it. Right, so let me bring you a little closer, explain, give you an overview of the parts and what I've done, and then I'm gonna fire it up. I'm gonna show you the error that I'm getting now and potentially why I'm getting that error and potentially how I hope to resolve it. Right then, so what I'll do a quick bit of freehand just to give you a walk around and a quick overview. Before I go into any discussion and then power it up and show you some of its operation. So here on the front, here if you compare, if I flick up the original eBay pictures, you'll see how grotty and dirty these keys were. Obviously, I removed all this and I've very carefully cleaned everything out. It was these two selection keys over here. So what these do is when you select various parameters that you want to change or settings, you'll get some soft settings displayed on the CRT, and these link to those. And I couldn't make any changes with these two keys over here. And if I flip up the PCB where the contacts are, but behind these rubber selection buttons, you'll see that obviously over time, it was either an oxide or dust had accumulated behind there. So just with a careful bit of cleaning, I managed to clean all of that up. I cleaned the rubber membranes of the keypads, and so it's all come up very nicely. So it really is nice to see a nice solid instrument like this come up nice and cleanly. It wasn't my intention to try and restore this or anything else. I just literally wanted for a reasonable price, because say, trying to find an analyzer that goes down between DC and 100 kilohertz, or certainly the audio frequency range, is difficult to find, and to find one that performs well. And this certainly does the job. But anyway, yeah, so I cleaned it up. If we come around to the side, the one thing to be wary of, obviously, I just want to warn you, if you happen to buy one of these and work on it, be very mindful of the high voltages in order of 8,000 volts to the CRT. There's a process where you say potentially put a probe or a screwdriver down behind the cap, the anode cap, and you hold it against the frame to discharge it. I used a test lead. I connected that to the body and used a screwdriver as a probe before I took everything apart to clean it. So just be very mindful of that. Also, make sure that you earthed yourself, because some of the components in here are sensitive to static. This device was the first device that Hewlett-Packard actually put bubble memory into. So if you want to go and read about magnetic bubble memory, there are some nice videos on YouTube. You can in fact still purchase bubble memory units. This doesn't have that option. This only has a little bit of CMOS memory, whereas some of these units came with a board of both CMOS and bubble memory. But this, in 1984, this was one of HP's first units to have bubble memory. Now, if we go around the unit over here, we can see the various bits. I've taken off some of the covers over there, which go on top of these cards to obviously protect them and provide some shielding. The only cards I didn't take out were, in fact, these two over here, which I believe go to control the CRT. There's quite a few wires and what have you. I'm always mindful, something of this age, sometimes the heat can make the wires and interconnects brittle, so I didn't want to risk any issue there. These cards slot in on old ISA bus. I think it's odd, like old PC ISA bus slots. So if you look down there, you can see ISA bus slots that the cards go into, just like old PCs. After taking out these longer cards and cleaning those and realizing how hard it was to get them back in, I thought, no, I'm not going to risk these over here. So this is the only area that I carefully blew out. I used a vacuum cleaner so that the airflow was not too high, and I used a soft bristle paintbrush, and I got all the dust out of literally all of it. I say there might be some literally just a little bit at the bottom, but for the most part, it is now clean and clear. So that is, I think, the key part that goes to the CRT. This is the controller board where you control the actual screen settings, the position of the beam and the focus and what have you is all controlled over here. And then these are the various cards. One of the cards has got a nice microprocessor on it or a microcontroller on it. You can see that down there. I will flip up some photographs that I took of these boards so that you can have a little bit of a closer look. I'm not going to pull out anything now. But basically, I took all these boards out. I did not take out the boards which have the signal. So this is the front end BNC connector, and it connects to this first stage board over here, which I believe does the attenuation. And this was the one board, and this is why I believe I've got an issue after doing some of the calibration. This is the one board I couldn't go through the calibration process. I will link to the service document. Again, that's the brilliant thing about equipment from this era. They came with really nice service manuals, and look at all the various test points. So you've got loads of test points. It even has a signal output at the back, which you feed back into the front to make some of the adjustments. It's got internal programs to run internal tests and diagnostics on the boards. So I must say, a lot of thought and technology for the time went into the making of this. So let me explain what I did in terms of calibration. It wasn't my intention to calibrate it. It was operating fine. I could see there is probably a slight offset in the amplitude readings. The frequency and what have you seems to be working fine. But the one thing I did notice that it seemed to have a fair bit of noise. The noise floor was higher than perhaps it should be. So I decided to do a calibration. The one issue with the calibration is if you go through the HP steps, they say put aside 5 hours, and I can believe it. All the individual checks and what have you that you have to write down is potentially a 5 hour process. You've then got a calibration process that starts off with checking the operation voltage, then checking the voltages to the CRT and changing the settings with test patterns and what have you on the CRT. Then the ones that become critical to the actual operation of the unit are the first one, and this is the one where I have a problem, is an adjustment to the reference oscillator. So if you look here, you can see there's an oscillator on this board over here. There's an air dielectric capacitor adjustment over here. And that, as I recall, is rated from about 2.1 picofarad to 13.5 or something like that. I'll put an annotation up on the screen. And basically, by turning that, you can see that it's got an air dielectric over there. You've got to adjust. You put in a test signal, and you need to adjust that test signal so that you don't have a big skirt on the signal that you're putting in. And that capacitor just doesn't seem to have the adjustment range. So I've taken this board out. I saw what looked like soot or dirt in the fins of the air dielectric. So I cleaned that out, but that didn't change anything. So what I've done, I've gone and found, in the UK, it looks like there's almost something that's the exact spec, but I have found ones which are similar on eBay. So I've ordered a couple. The one in the UK only costs $4, but you need to make a minimum order of $40 odd. So I thought I'll attempt with the ones off eBay, which are roughly within the same specification and the same size. They won't have exactly the same pinout, but I should be able to take this board out and carefully connect it to that position. And anyway, I'll show you that result. And I believe that is the cause of the error that I'm getting. So that is the first step. And unfortunately, if you don't get this first step right, even though I've followed through with other steps, you potentially have an issue. If you can't get the first one right, I've made the adjustments to all the others. When I say all the others, the one thing I couldn't do was the adjustments to the front end attenuation. So this board that sits in here has got some pots and adjustments, but you have to disconnect the signal. So here is a little RF cable. You have to disconnect that, pull this board out, and then presumably HP have a part. They have a isobus extender. So you put that extender on, because then you lift this board out above the shielding. The shielding is all screwed on. It's screwed to the front of the case over here. So you lift that board out, so it's obviously sitting up here, and then you can make those adjustments. So there was no way that I could do that calibration. But anyway, I did the rest. I inserted a signal in here. I did the various adjustments that I could, but I say unfortunately now when I power it up, it has this error, and the error is a code, I think it's 1604, and from the service manual it states that the noise floor is sitting a bit high, and I think that is due to, as I said, the issue with the skirt. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to power it up. I'll show you that error. It certainly doesn't stop the functionality of what I need to do with this, but it would be nice to get that resolved, because I say now it's potentially a nice, clean, working device. The one last thing I'll just show you, the one thing I noted that was missing, one of the screws, you can see is missing from up here. It wasn't missing from there, it was actually missing from the side over here. So there are four screws which hold this front panel in place. And I noted when this arrived, and I've seen this on eBay, several of these, where this side of the screen is kind of hanging out. And I thought it was maybe an adhesive which was coming loose, but no, it's screwed in. But I imagine these screws, which are tiny, are probably the first to get lost if any of these devices are being serviced. So one was lost here. So what I did was I obviously used one here, because mechanically, there's no issue. You've got quite a few other screws holding this front panel on. So this whole front of the device comes off with the CRT. I've got photographs showing it where I pulled that off and carefully took apart and cleaned it all up and then put it all together again. But this all nicely comes apart, the panel, so you can get to everything and actually service these with relative ease. It took me about 2 days of finding my way around it, taking it apart and cleaning it up. But I say, I'm very happy with what's happened. But anyway, let me power it up and then I can show you its operation. Before I power it up, I realized I didn't show you the back, so I'll just show you the back end and the connections on the back here. You can see there's an HBIB connection over there. You've got the source, a sync source, an external sample, and an external trigger. This source out is what can be used to do the calibration. Some interesting bit of writing which I'm just noticing for the first time. A serial number, I believe, and with my glass, I'm just struggling to read whether this is a company or an original sticker on there. This may have been from, these may be from other companies, but this is the main tag on the top end over here, which initially when I saw it, I thought might be a calibration sticker, but I think this is the original manufacturing date. So it's got the date. The 20th of the 4th, 1988, and I presume that by is a code for perhaps someone who assembled it, and then I assume a serial number. So that is the back. I'll just flip it up so you can see the underside. So this is the underside of the machine, again, nicely made with the feet, so it's nice and easy to stand up and service it. A nice big board with a nice ground plane on it. This is where you make the selections for your mains voltage over here. And I've just had a realization actually while just prior to powering this up as to what the problem might be. So let me just show you. Right, so it's funny how suddenly things hit you, and this is obviously a very amateur mistake that I might have made. We'll see if it does correct the problem. But one of the last things I had to do, there was an adjustment to adjust the DC, the start of the DC noise. You can get the first start of the scale. You potentially might have a DC offset that you need to adjust. And I had to take these plates off in order to do some of these adjustments. And I've just realized that when I powered it on to then finish off and check to see whether it was working, I had it literally like this, just with the one cover on and not the cover over here. So basically the covers you can see on my bench over there go over the top here, and they act as shields to the input circuitry. And if you don't have those input shields, that may be introducing noise and elevating the noise floor. It still doesn't resolve the issue, as I said, with the oscillator adjustment, which I'll show you, but potentially my problem might be caused by that. But anyway, so we'll take a look. So let me power it up and just show you. Right then, so we're going to power it up. I actually just did a power up just prior to switching, forgetting to put the record on, so the CRT might be warm. And what happens is when the CRT isn't warm and you power it up, you actually miss some of the power on test. You don't actually see this, because the CRT isn't warm, but you do see it once the CRT is warm. But here we go, it's come up with a beep, it's come up with a system error, and we can see the error there, and I'll just bring it in. There might be some flicker, obviously because of the CRT going conflicting with my camera, but you can see the error 1604, and that is the noise floor, which I say we're going to see whether I can solve by just putting the shielding back on. It gives you a software revision. I'm very happy with the brightness and what you can see on the CRT, but the one thing I forgot to mention was that there is an eBay seller that actually sells an LCD, color LCD replacement for the CRT. So you can actually take out the CRT, put in an LCD, and actually it gives color grading as well, dependent on the signal that comes in. And that potentially is a nice upgrade to this. Now, I say nice upgrade, I actually like the idea of having the CRT. It'll be interesting to see how fast the LCD performs, because obviously there's some processing, and in which case I wouldn't want any slow up in the signal on the display, and that's why I say perhaps I prefer the CRT. Right, so we can get past this error. You'll see there are lights on that come up around here. These come up as part of the power on self test. They can also indicate an error. Various lights go on and off. You can see there's one light off there, and in the service manual it shows you what that means. We can get past this error quite easily. We just push the preset button, and here we get, and again, here is a really nice handy feature of this FFT dynamic signal analyzing, in that we get the time domain and the frequency domain can be displayed at the same time. We can also obviously go to, if we go to format and I go to single, so you just push a button on the side of the screen, you can then obviously get full screen of what you want. You can have, if I push this button still, even though I've cleaned it, so if I give it a harder push, there we go. These are the two buttons which are problematic. Up and lower is the two screens. I need to be very careful with my fingers because got the CRT nearby. Front to back actually displays both signals on the screen at the same time. Because I haven't got a signal coming in, we cannot see the frequency domain. You then can also do a map. I haven't spent enough time to understand the magnitude map, but you can map out over time. Look, it actually gives you a nice mapping over time of the signal. And again, I can see you getting interference on the camera, but and again, another interesting feature of this. You can go to single, I'll go back to the single display, but a nice, fast, easy to read display. I'm very, very chuffed with that. Right, so before I put any signals in, what I'm going to do, I'm going to pull back, I'm going to put the covers back on it and see if that resolves that error. Right, I'm just going to lift you up just to show you. I've replaced the shielding back onto the unit. It'd be really fortuitous if that does resolve the problem, but there's half a chance. Let's just have a look. No, still the same error, so I still need to replace that capacitor. Okay, so let me put what I'm going to do is I'm going to connect up the test signal just to demonstrate the issue with that reference oscillator adjustment. And then after I've done that, we can look at a few more signals. Right then, so I thought what I'd do is I'll just show you, hopefully my camera doesn't, the focus doesn't seek too much. I'll just show you the process of setting up to put this test signal in. From the signal generator, it's a 1 volt RMS signal at 99 kilohertz that we put in. I'll switch that on. There we go. We can see the signal is actually right at the end of this of the display because we stop at 100 kilohertz. So what we need to do is go and put it in just the single mode. So we just get the big screen. We then go and set the frequency so that we are set to a center frequency of 99 kilohertz. So that gets us there. And then we want a span. So we go and select span and we want 5 kilohertz. I also need to change the type of FFT windowing. So we need to go to window and we need uniform. So here we go. So here you can see this big skirt on the signal. There are two crosshairs to give an amplitude reading and a frequency reading, and those are noted down here on the screen. So you can see it's saying 99 kilohertz or 99,000 hertz over here, and the Y is giving us the dB voltage reading over here. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to now adjust it, and I'll show you the amount of adjustment which is available. Right then, so I'm just ready to just show you what happens when I make the adjustment. So we've got the signal in here. The one thing I have done, I've switched off auto ranging because of the noise, it seems the auto ranging is jumping around and there are relays which tend to be make a little bit of noise and are annoying. So I've adjusted the range just so it doesn't overload. And what I'll do now is adjust that capacitor. You can adjust the signal up or down, and basically what you're supposed to do, I'm turning it right round, you can see it going back down, and what you're supposed to do is get the skirt, that noise in the skirt, right below the minus 80 dB, or below the noise floor, so that you've just got a straight spike. So I'll show you from the manual what it's supposed to look like, and the range of adjustment is just not letting me get there. Even when I get it right down to the lowest point I can, when I come off with a tool, it goes slightly up. What I've also been looking for, it's measuring the magnitude of the signal. You can see the y-axis over here. So you can see, even though I'm trying to get the skirt below the line, I've also been noting the magnitude of the signal when I've made adjustments. So I've tried both methods and that hasn't worked. I'm assuming that perhaps that air capacitor is out of spec and it doesn't have the range within the capacitance within a full 360 rotation for this adjustment. I'm hoping that's the case. It doesn't stop the operation of this device, but it would be nice to get that within spec. And then probably what I'll have to do, because going through the calibration steps out of step, you potentially mess things up, is once, if I can get that corrected, I'll then step through all the calibration procedures that I can. I say, noting that the front end adjustment I can't do, but for the most part, the front end seems to be fairly accurate. Right, so let me just demonstrate a few bits and pieces. I certainly don't have a full understanding of this analyzer yet. I haven't had enough time with it, but I'll just demonstrate a few things. I'm going to put the marker on. I've got a signal coming in from my signal generator, just a sine wave at the moment. So for one, I'm going to put the marker on so that it tracks the peak. So I switch that on. Those readings, so now if you read the X and the Y, you can see the X 59, let me just check. Yeah, I'm on 59 kilohertz on my signal generator. Depending on your resolution bandwidth and the span that you're looking at, might affect the accuracy of the frequency reading, but for the most part I've seen it's pretty well spot on. As I said, the amplitude reading, I've noted that sometimes that can be a little bit off. The auto ranging is back on. The little yellow light over here shows that. So what I'm going to do is just increase the amplitude. Can you hear those relays in the back? So those are the relays, I think, doing the auto ranging, and you can see the range changing as I change the signal. Right, so as I show you the signal, what I'm going to do, sometimes if I go out of spec, the auto range is jumping around and can slow the machine up. So what I'm going to do is just take it out of auto range. I'm just going to decrease the amplitude of the signal so that we don't overload the front end. But then as I move the signal, you can see how quickly it moves, but if I did this on my Regal scope, it just wouldn't be able to track that with that level of resolution that quickly. And that is the beauty of this, is that it is really fast within the 100 kilohertz of range that this is operating in. So that is a signal. I mean, if I pull up, if I go to format and go up and lower, That is the actual frequency. So if I drop the frequency, there we go, you can see the signal. And because I've got the auto ranging off, it's not auto ranging, I'm now going to change to a square wave. So bang, there's a square wave, and that's what I'm after. I'm going to go back to a single display, is being able to look at an instrument and its harmonics and have the range to see where those harmonics are, to then get into an understanding of what a DAC will do, the cutoff filters, low pass filters in a DAC, and to see whether these harmonics are of any consequence. I already have answers in my head, but I just want to be able to see that myself, because what I can do is pass a signal through a DAC through here, and you can actually see how the low pass filter, when it's not acting properly, you get aliasing coming back into your recording signal. I'm obviously talking about a digital audio recording. I've already done that experiment on my Regal, but I said it's a bit slow. But now having this, I can demonstrate that virtually real time and what happens. So just out of interest, if I change the frequency of that square wave, we can see the harmonics change. I'm going to drop the frequency of the fundamental, and we can see all the harmonics. So this is a one kilohertz signal, and we can see all the harmonics going right off down to 100 kilohertz. But anyway, so that's the HP3561A. Right then, so that is the HP3561A. The last thing I forgot to show you, this is the top. I'm obviously leaving these off until I've finished working on it. But it comes with a pouch on the top, and this one did come with, I did get a power cord, it did come with the original operating manual and a book on using it. So I must say, I was very chuffed at least these came along with it, even though it wasn't in proper working order or as clean as the seller stated. I'm still very relatively happy that it's a good unit and that I've managed to resolve, clean up the buttons and get it operational. And again, it's just amazing how this old vintage equipment still fulfills such a good role so much time later, because to try and buy a contemporary device that does what this device does for the frequency range and its performance would cost a lot of money. So I say, there are still some good pieces of equipment from this era to be found on eBay and the like. But anyway, I hope you enjoyed the video. I will bring you back when I get that part, if I manage to resolve the issue with setting the reference oscillator correctly to remove that skirt from the reference test. I hope that works, not the end of the world if it doesn't. And then I'll lead into the series where I'm going to do, the main reason I've got this is to do these demonstrations with audio, recording and playing back audio, both analog and digital, and understanding the fundamentals of DACs, the sampling rate, what the microphone capability, speaker capability versus your ears, what do you really need? And that, I say, that's going to be another video series. But anyway, thanks very much for watching, and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.